One thing that I love about ecovillages is how it allows all of us to come back to ourselves and come back to that higher alignment also, where we allow higher guidance to come through us so that our lives, our very lives, become songs. And we become songlines again. Our lives on this earth become songlines, creating healing and beauty as we walk. And it's only through time that we're maturing into a place where we understand that we need to recreate economy in a way that nurtures life. And we can create economies, cyclical economies, economies of love, as the Sekhem ecovillage in Egypt calls it, where we can create income in a way that nurtures and replenishes and regenerates nature, that regenerates the people that are working, and where the products heal society.
Hi, this is Bruce Lipton, and you're listening to Planet FM.
Kia ora, greetings, and welcome to Planet FM 104.6. I'm Tim Lynch, and I trust that you are doing well. I invite you to stay with me over the next hour as we discuss and find ways to take care of our unique and magnificent green planet Earth. In the studio this morning, I have Kosha Joubert, and she is from South Africa. She is also the executive director of the Global Ecovillage Network, which is a network of ecovillages that are popping up right around our planet, Mother Earth, at this very moment. And she's come to Aotearoa, New Zealand, to want to share so many good things that are happening, because in mainstream news, we never really hear about the wonderful positive things that are happening deep in the rural sector. Away from the cities, we find that there are so many things that are happening that are really pulling the strings of community together, not only in nations, but across our planet. And so I wish to say kia ora, Kosha. Thank you for wanting to share your message today.
Kia ora, Tim. And it's really lovely to be here today. I have had the most exquisite landing, I have to say, in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and also finding out about all the projects that are popping up right here in New Zealand, in Aotearoa. So really excited to be here with you today.
Well, we're very lucky here because we're the last sort of major country to be colonialized, some would say invaded. And as a result, we were able to sort of start with a cleaner slate than the earlier colonializations. And you'll find across New Zealand, co-ops and cooperation were embedded very early in the peace in this country. And just the word of cooperating leads us to realize that we are sharing something that's far greater than our own sort of personal input. We're working together for the benefit of the whole. So tell us a little bit more about the Global Ecovillage Network.
Okay, great. I'd love to do that. The Global Ecovillage Network was set up in 1995, and it didn't start by creating ecovillages or spreading the impulse to create ecovillages. It actually started by reading the field of human beings and understanding that around the planet, everywhere, people were coming together, understanding that our mainstream culture was going in a direction of actually destroying the fabric of life that we live within, and people understanding that we need to reconnect to our duty of care, to our guardianship of life, and also reconnecting to the power of community. I think those two strands, the power of community, our duty of care, coming together in this impulse to create communities on the ground that not only sustain life, but actually start regenerating the life that we are a part of. So finding out that there are communities and impulses like this in all countries around the planet, and we keep reaching out to new areas that we haven't been in before. Like a few years ago, we reached out to the North African countries, and we had no idea how much is actually happening on the ground there around the same impulse So we're linking people, networking people in the Global Ecovillage Network, like-minded people of great integrity. And from that, we allow the knowledge, the experience, the solutions to be seen more broadly. We showcase them as much as possible. We distill the experience, the knowledge that is emerging from all these places. And then we distill it into patterns, into tools, into inspiration that can be spread easily and inspire more people to follow the same impulse. That's basically what we're doing.
Yes, well, you're getting people to cooperate, support each other, but the creative thought and the novelty comes through when people work synergistically for the betterment of the whole. You've noticed this, don't you?
That's right. And very often we see that it's maybe one person who stands up tall and who's a connector, a link person. Yeah, these might be people starting from an impulse of permaculture or co-housing or transition town. So people coming with an impulse, often actually in a moment of deep connectedness that they themselves have had, maybe a very personal experience in nature or in their own reconnecting to their own indigenous culture. So a deep inner calling that people connect to that are often the seed of such a project. But then we see no one can do this alone. So that impulse to go out and spread to a community, include the power of community. And that's where really the impulse for being part of the solution merges with the power of community to create eco-villages. And maybe that's also just to say here, like what we work with is a whole field, a whole layering of projects now in Gen, even though at the heart of what we do lies the concept of eco-village, a concept that includes love for place, that includes all four areas of regeneration, ecology, economy, social, and culture, brought together into an in participatory design process for regeneration. But we start from eco-citizens, inspiring individuals. How much of an eco-village lifestyle are you living? Whether you live in Auckland or New York or out in the countryside, to eco-projects, all kinds of projects that are basically spreading these regenerative lifestyle, like urban gardening projects, green cafe, a green school, a business that is transforming itself. We have many of these that are part of our networks, to eco-communities, smaller communities starting to work together, up to 20 adults. Above that, we call it eco-village. Then we have eco-neighborhoods, eco-cities, eco-regions, eco-nations, and eco-civilizations. So it's a whole movement of transforming human presence on the planet, starting from the very small seeds in individuals up to societal change.
So the whole ecosphere, the biosphere of our planet, is where we draw our connection from. It's like I saw your TEDx show last night and you talked about that we share breath. Well, the whole human race shares breath. And when I take this to where I like to go is that everyone has an inner candle. And the best thing for a candle, shared breath and oxygen, allows our inner candle to glow. And so what we're wanting to do in the whole network of eco-villages is to be able to bring people together whose inner candle is glowing inside so that they can be the leaders of today and tomorrow.
That's exactly right. You know, and there's two things. One thing is that in Gen, what we really believe in is that one of the most underutilized and most important resources we have is the good intentions of all people, the good intentions of citizens, our wish to be part of the solution. And if we can show people a pathway there, they love to go there. You know, whoever I speak with, whether it's politicians at the highest levels, at the United Nations, where we speak regularly, at the European Union, in corporations, on the earth, all of us have grandchildren, have nieces, nephews, you know, and there's this longing deep in our heart to leave our world a better place for our having been present here.
You bet. Yeah, this is imperative because I know that I've been around for enough years to know that when I was born, there was so much more pristine nature than there is now. I realise that we as a humanity have to really take care of the garden instead of fighting over the turf, to take a reference from Bruce Lipton, is that we humans just need to realise that when we work together, I know I've volunteered, and when we volunteer and we have a day's work, at the end of the day, boy, isn't everybody happy? And you'll notice this too, particularly with permaculture. When you're working in the garden with people, the joy at the end of the day, well, there's joy usually at the start of the day too, because you realise the synergy of people working in harmony. And we're a microcosm of the global family working in these little gardens and all these little networks, doing our best to make sure that children of today and tomorrow have a wonderful future.
That's right. And the word oikos or eco actually means home. So I think what we're speaking about here in this kind of work or play in our lives is really about coming home to the planet in a much deeper way. At the moment, it feels like we're still living as if we're in a foreign, strange place where we have to fight to survive. We have to use resources faster than they regrow. And so to come back to this trust that we as human beings are meant to be here, that we are not the illness of Homo sapiens befalling the planet, but actually we are a gift. And our intelligence, our love is what heals, what is a healing impulse. That's who we are meant to be, a healing impulse on the planet, not a destructive element. So believing that deeply and really reconnecting to, as you said at the beginning, that deep leadership that lies in each of us, which is our own personal, I call it the red thread that lies in our hearts, that starts in our hearts. You know, we have that inner compass saying, this alights my curiosity. This is where my passion goes alive, you know. And then we just start following that red thread. And it will lead us to the paths less traveled. We won't be able to just follow the highways of main civilization as it's laid out for us. You know, we'll refine all those pathways leading us back into wilderness. We'll refine ways to create, allow more wilderness to come closer to us as we live our lives as humans. So also, in all reality, creating more space for nature to take space again. But we'll also, each of us, find our contribution at this time. And I like to think of human beings as a puzzle, where if each of us would take care of our piece of the puzzle, none of us would have too much to do, and we could create a beautiful planet now.
I agree 100% with you. Because if you could see the 7.7 billion human beings, we are all parts of the puzzle. And yet we haven't found our way to fit in yet. And I maintain that when we slowly all come together, or I'd say now rapidly, come together, when that last puzzle, piece of that puzzle drops in, unity consciousness will come across the whole face of our planet. And then that's when we all jump up to another level of coming together, of working for the benefit of the whole, and the global family will spring out of it.
That's, yeah, I couldn't agree more. And, you know, I feel that in Gen and the Global Ecovillage Network, we're doing preparatory work. We're preparing the ground in our way as part of a much bigger movement around the planet. And I think it's also my growing up in South Africa under apartheid, this separation between human beings that was so painful to become aware of as a child in a system and then stand up against. I think that's been the fire that's ignited my passion, and that I also bring in my humble way to the networks of Gen, where we have big regional networks in all of the continents, in Africa, Latin America, North America, Europe, Asia, Oceania, emerging in the Fertile Crescent, the Middle East. So And all these communities, we share. We have the General Assembly, like also in our structures, where there's 9 representatives of each of the regions. We have the youth networks. We have Gen Elders. So there's that big diversity, also cultural diversity coming back in Gen. At the very center, we have the Gen Board with 2 representatives from each of the regions. So there's always that intercultural conversation happening. And when I hear about the next natural disaster hitting, say Mozambique, say the floods in Zimbabwe, the next hurricane in the Philippines, or the next floods in Bangladesh, I don't hear about this through the news. I hear about this through our brothers and sisters. And it's our communities being hit. It's us being hit. It's our children who've had their food resources for the next 6 months destroyed, you know? And it's like it goes right through our hearts when it's not just an abstract news item, but it's us. It's like, it's so being in Gen, in all honesty, is like a constant stretching of the heart to encompass the living beings, but also to encompass all parts of this planet and know that this is not a time to speak about acknowledging climate emergency as much as standing up and supporting each other in the climate emergency that is currently being fully experienced by so many on the planet. I would say half of our global population is already experiencing the emergency. The other half are considering, shall we acknowledge the climate emergency or not?
The astronauts, when they look back at Earth, they called it a home planet. And you said oikos, which is Greek, which means taking care of the household. And the ancient Greeks knew way back that our planet was a living being. From her, she lends us a body. She lends us a body. She lends us free air, free rainwater, and until recently, a free food chain. What do we do in reciprocity? And as you say, Kosha, half the planet are still trying to work it all out, while the other half are desperately, in many ways, wanting to come together in their own countries and work in community and make sure that they've got food in their tummy and rent or shelter where they live. And so these are the challenges, because nurture, Mother Earth is a mother. She has given us all these wonderful elements in which to exist. But the nurturement also comes from the mother. And I'm very strong on this as a male, because I know that it's a mother tiger that takes care of her baby, her cubs. It's a mother elephant. It's a cow. I've been chased by a cow when I went and saw her calves when I was really young, because she was wanting to protect her babies. And so there's this quality of care, isn't it? It's actually built in to the human condition. And I know some wonderful dads, but it is time for us to really start nurturing ourselves and our families, our neighbours and our community. And this is really what I like about the Global Eco Network, because we are realising now that we can't buy into all this corporate stuff. It's just going into separation and fragmentation. We have to share our realization that we are kin on Mother Earth, and we're all connected. And our navel, our belly button, back through my mum and grandmother and grandmothers, all the way back through the family tree, and the spiraling DNA back through the lineage of species somewhere along the line, we have come 4.5 billion years ago from a molten, gaseous Mother Earth. We're all connected. We're all connected. We've been given this magnificence, the garden, and it's time now to reclaim the garden and get back and do what needs to be done for us and our children and our grandchildren.
Yeah, and you know, at the heart of all of our legal systems is actually this enshrinement of the duty of care of human beings. And it's only above that heart that all the layers of law have been put on top. And often with high investment by those that are more privileged to protect ownership. So coming back to the heart of our law, I think our legal systems, our political systems need to change.
Yes.
To put the protection of life at the center of the duty of care. And we have people closely connected to our networks now that are really working towards earth rights, the ecocide law, to actually
yes.
bring people to justice who have not fulfilled their duty of care. People in leadership in the oil industry who consciously veiled what was happening around climate change to ensure their profits for two decades more, while the global society is moving into a state that is heartbreaking. So, yeah, and I, you know, just to speak also about the motherhood, because I think this is the age where as men and women, we need to come together and work together. We see that the community idea is an idea that naturally attracts a lot of women first. And it's especially the young mothers, you know, and I can speak as a mother here because I brought up two kids in an eco-village. And the idea of being isolated somewhere in a house with my children, it needs a village to bring up children healthily. It needs a community. And I've seen my kids flourish in a community setting where there's lots of other adults
yes,
to connect to, you know. So it's that part, there's a strong movement from the mothers, yeah, towards eco-villages and communities. And then the fathers coming in and coming back to their original wish, which is not just to go out and work from 9 to 5 every day to make money, but really to protect life. Yeah, so, and you know, I think there's also something else because you spoke about the indigenousness. In a way, you spoke about the ancient history that we come from and our indigenous roots. And since the onset of this community impulse, you know, which led to the intentional community movement, permaculture, the eco-village network, there's always been a close friendship with the indigenous people, starting maybe in the U.S. with the rainbow movement. A lot of influx from wisdom from the Native American elders, the indigenous people's wisdom. Yes, that's right. So, you know, it's always been there in Gen, and we've had this interesting alliance between intentional communities, often coming from middle class backgrounds, and traditional communities, traditional settlements, indigenous communities, where at the beginning there's always been both that have been integral part of the Global Ecovillage Network. But in past years, we've seen the balance flip where we have many more traditional and indigenous communities joining us to be recognized as ecovillages, while more and more intentional ecovillages are also coming up and urban neighborhoods. So we have that beautiful balance. And I think this is where, coming back to where you started with the special opportunity that we have here in Aotearoa, New Zealand, where the scars of cruelty, the scars of war, the scars of subjugation, they run deep, but they don't run as deep as in many other places in the world. And I've felt that since I've come here. I felt that this is a place where healing has an opportunity to take place in a different way. You know, my ancestors arrived in South Africa in 1672. That's a long time of, and a lot of cruelty in that past.
Ensured, yes.
You know, in Scotland, where I live now in the eco-village of Fintorn, that's a lot of centuries of cruelty against the Gaelic people and the Highland clearances, you know. So indigenousness everywhere on this planet has been subjugated, has been cruelly dispersed, languages being forbidden, cultures being forbidden, and now standing back up. So it feels that in our global conversation that we're having in Gen around decolonization, how do we truly find our way back to indigenousness on this planet, as all people on this planet, which is what we originally meant, you know. And what is the special role also that the Maori elders, the Maori wisdom, the Maori culture here in New Zealand can play? And we just had our first workshop here in Auckland and in a Maori...
Marae.
Yeah. And so beautiful for me also to tap into, learn from the depth of wisdom that is alive in the very language, how it is spoken, how it is brought out. So, you know, there's a very clear intention here in New Zealand, in Aotearoa, to put the marae and the Maori communities very much at the center of learning around eco-village living here.
This is very important, what you are saying, Kosha, because it is true. I've done a number of interviews with Maori, naturally, because I'm part Maori myself. And Ruth Tai is on greenplanetfm.com. She has been able to break down the language to its constituents, parts, and essentially it's a light language that goes right back into the past. Very, very interesting, very powerful. And I came across a Maori friend, and he talked to me one day. He said, "Oh, Tim," he said, "do you know what aroha means?" And I said, "Oh, yes. Well, you know, it's love. It's unconditional love. It's our feeling together." He says, "Yes," but he said, "the highest aspiration of aroha is what is mine is yours, and what is yours is mine." Now, wow, this is taking it to an incredible high level. And this is what we've lost. And I've debated a lot, and I've talked about it a lot of times, about how the colonial coming of people, we had the stuff, and we collected, we had houses, and then we had walls around houses and this sort of thing, and we lived separately, whereas Māori or Marae or Ngāpā lived community. They cooperated together under the auspices of a riki or a tohanga or rangatira, but there was always with a group energy. And what we have now with Jen is that we're coming back, but we've also been able to fire up our own inner creativity and work harmoniously for the betterment of the whole.
Yeah, Ruth Tuller McQueenie is one of the Maori elders who actually came to speak to us, and I've interviewed her before, so bringing her knowledge out. She's also one of the Maori elders who's really deeply touched by the concept of eco-village and how we are speaking about it now. So, you know, distilling the knowledge from communities on the ground, both traditional, indigenous, intentional people researching their roots, we found a pattern at the heart of it, which we call the map of regeneration and the eco-village principles. So these are principles that together would make up the most beautiful world we know in our hearts is possible. And there are principles in ecology like growing seed, food, and soils 100% organically without pesticides, or moving towards 100% renewable energy. Or in the social, taking inclusive and responsive decisions together, having accountable institutions, etc. So they're simple principles, but they run very deep. And I think one of the very touching things I found, both here in Aotearoa and in Australia before, is that we've had the Indigenous elders come and look at this map and say, "This is the map that expresses how we used to live as well. This is a map that we can so easily translate to our language, to our living. This is a house or a network that we could feel at home in as well." So one of the concrete steps coming from the training here in Auckland is that the Ecovillage design cards and this map will be taken by Maori elders and will be translated and adapted to the Maori language and the Maori culture. And their wisdom will then be fed back into the global Ecovillage network in that way, so that we can all keep learning from these traditions, like the Maori, like the First Nations in Australia, whose history goes back 60,000 years on the land, and they knew.
Yeah.
They knew. Mm. And it's not just the cooperation in community, it's also the cooperation with all living beings. And as they say, singing all of life back into life every day by our presence. Singing life back into life, which I find here in Maori culture as well, that the songs,
yes.
You know, it's like singing into life. That's what we're meant to do.
I'm speaking with Kosha Joubert, and she's the Executive Director of the Global Ecovillage Network, known as GEN, G-E-N. And the website is ecovillage.org, ecovillage.org. Well, this is the beauty of it. I know that when we sing, the vibrations just lift.
Mm.
And you'll find a lot of Polynesian people here. We have 100 community gardens here in Auckland.
Mm.
And you have a huge number of different races coming and working together. But you'll find numerous ones, or a number of them, singing as they work. And the Polynesians love singing. This is one of their, the sort of a glue for Polynesia. Because they're an oral language, they sing.
And as you travel around the world and you go to the traditional village, we all sing.
Mm.
Like go to Africa, you know, I just remember like being in the Gambia and our eco-village participants, you know, they just, like whenever something beautiful happens, someone will just stand up spontaneously and create a new song to celebrate the moment. And it doesn't take 5 minutes for the whole community to get it and sing and dance together. So this, or Latin America, and even in Europe, this is coming back in the Ecovillage Network, the co-creation of songs to celebrate life.
Well, one of the main reasons is because you're grounded, and I know I love working barefoot, but the other thing is when you're working together, you're not involved in the outside world of advertising and products and all the gunk that goes with things, because you're so busy in your own field of energy working for the betterment of your local group. And this is where the inspiration and this is where happiness comes in. And so when you sing, you're basically intuiting the words, but just coming through. You're a conduit in many ways between heaven and earth.
That's right. And this whole advertisement world that keeps telling us and telling our children that we are not beautiful enough, we are not good enough as we are, we need more
stuff.
You know, more stuff. Our voices are not beautiful enough to allow them to speak what is in our hearts. What is in our hearts is not important enough to be spoken. Our songs are not worthy of singing, you know, to break through that. And once we come together in communities, that happens naturally. It starts happening naturally. One thing that I love about eco-villages is how it allows all of us to come back to ourselves and come back to that higher alignment also, where we allow higher guidance to come through us so that our lives, our very lives, become songs. And we become songlines again. Our lives on this earth become songlines, creating healing and beauty as we walk.
That's right. And as a global family, the symphony comes into being at heart, unity consciousness and at one-ment with us on a grand scale.
Because there's something happening now, and this is this, as we come closer to the crisis point, or we are in the crisis point, as we said before, and more people are waking up, there is something happening that I would like to bring present here, which is a scaling up of what we can do.
That's what I like
because
to hear.
Where yes. we are today is that we know, you know, in effect, in our language, we know that every community needs to become an eco-village. Every city needs to become an eco-city. Every neighborhood needs to become an eco-neighborhood. And we have the tools, we have the solutions to help make that transition. We have the people with the good intentions who are ready to start working together to make that transition. And we've been bringing this information out into the world because GEN the intentional community movement, the eco-village movement, have started up as like hidden out islands out in the green, like hiding out, bringing back this wisdom, creating laboratories for how to create new healing culture. Yeah. Now we've gathered that. We have a solution library that brings together 500 solutions that go across all areas of regeneration.
Yes. You know,
we've been bringing this out, sharing with academia, with governments, at the United Nations, and we've started breaking through. You know, and sometimes I speak about the networks, it's like all these incredible hubs on the ground, deeply rooted in the soil where the real solutions are being constantly generated. The love is being generated. And then we distill that into our national networks, into our regional networks, up to the global level, and we showcase the inspiration of Ecovillage, the incredible solutions to the broader society. And from there, we've started being seen and being heard. And the language that we used to use in 1995 when we just started is now being used by mainstream. And we've had governments, like the first government was in Senegal, seeing, wow, something is happening on the ground here.
Always has been for a long time now. There's something unique about Senegal.
Yeah, is that right? So starting to see there's something special happening on the ground. We have a network of 45 traditional villages transitioning to eco-villages. They are doing something without great outside development aid coming in, which is bringing them to flourishing, to growing. How can we learn from this for the other villages in Senegal, for the well-being of the country? And the Senegalese government set up a national development plan for transitioning 14,000 traditional villages to eco-villages.
14,000?
Yeah, and this started in 2010. Yeah, and of course, it's super interesting bringing a bottom-up development and then turning it down and bringing top-down support for a bottom-up development. So it's not been without a hitch. But we have far above 500 to 1,000 eco-villages now in the whole of Senegal. But this is not where it ends, because this has been jumping over like a virus. We now have 23 governments in the world that have expressed their interest to Gen to start implementing national eco-village development programs. So scaling up eco-village development, we're currently working with governments in Zimbabwe, Sierra Leone, the Gambia, Morocco, Mozambique, but we've also been invited in Scotland, in Germany, in Spain to start transitioning traditional villages more large scale to eco-villages. So this is exciting stuff.
It certainly is. Now in Spain, the cooperative Mondragon, have you been there? Because this is a very interesting cooperative. It started in about 1956, and they've got something like about 56,000 people working in this cooperative. It's in the Basque land, and it's a hidden, it's a very hidden gem. It's an oasis of what's happening. And so I just thought I'd ask that. It's like Damanhur, again, in northern Italy, and I got to within 200 kilometres of it last year. I'm going to get there. But there are these special places around our planet that are already working, and we have got them here in New Zealand. They're quietly going, and Robina McCurdy, our star goddess of the garden, and she comes from the Tui community down in the northern South Island. And again, there are other communities up and down New Zealand who are now really starting to move. Project Littleton, just beside Christchurch, is a very good example of how a community can start in the city or in a town, not necessarily in the rural sector. And, of course, there's Auroville and Pondicherry in India. And now they're starting to finally taking the next step forward. And no doubt, I mean, I've spent a lot of time going around to all sorts of communities in my life, way back Crystal Waters and just north of Brisbane in Queensland, or about, I don't know, 30 years ago. And so it is a time, and there's a woman called Barbara Marks Hubbard. I don't know if you know of her. I've interviewed her and met her, and she and a number of friends started off the first global family, which I joined. And what she's saying now is that we are in the birth canal to a higher level of synergy where we can now start replicating all the good things that have already happened and putting them in place in other countries, and we tweak them for that particular country. But this is all part of this groundswell, this grassroots movement that's happening. And hearing what you say about Senegal just makes my heart leap to hear so many thousands. Because I know just in, say, Austria alone is over 12,000 organic farms. Well, boy, there is, and the media is not doing its job. And so this is why greenplanetfm.com, and I want to push that so that people can hear that there are, when they go up to the website, there's many, many different groups throughout New Zealand doing the wonderful things that you sing about.
Yeah.
Kosha.
And so many of these communities that you've just named are part of the Global Ecovillage Network. So this is exactly the groundswell that we're speaking about. We currently reach out to over 6,000 communities worldwide. And this is just the beginning. We have more linking in every day. So it's also a calling to all of our listeners. You know, if you know of some of these very special places that are not yet linked up, invite them to link up, because it's coming from the ground, it's coming through the people, and it's always much bigger than what we can already see. It's coming from below the surface, and it's about making it more visible, which is the work you do and the work that Jen does in different ways.
Yes, thank you. In 2015, I went up to Russia checking on the ringing cedar books, the books.
They're part of Jen as well,
and
the
whole
Anastasia movement.
And I stayed with them. I was up there for a month, and I didn't speak to any Americans or English or Australians or anybody. I was only with the Russians, and they were doing it. There were 400 families on this big block of land. And so we take inspiration from the knowing that it's happening. But first, we've got to commit. That's the key, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, so this, the commitment is also to real change. And I think one weakness in our movement for a long time has been that we haven't measured the change. So I just want to, you know, this, what is beginning with these governments is currently spreading. We're seeing an influx of support also coming with that. And one thing that we're going to be doing this year is spreading the Ecovillage impact assessment that we've already run 2 years ago with 30 showcase ecovillages around the world. And we're going to be running it with 100 ecovillages worldwide and bringing the results of that to the climate change conference in Chile. And showcasing the impact that all these beautiful hubs of regeneration have, not just on the nature right around them or the people right around them, but even beyond their immediate boundaries into their bioregions, is astounding. And if we can bring this information out in a way that can be read and understood by mainstream, it's like an unleashing of the next flow of energy, of support for this movement. So I would invite everyone who listens to this to go to the ecovillage.org website to have a look at the materials, the inspiration. If you feel called, sign up for the newsletter and receive news regularly about what is happening in these beautiful hubs worldwide. See how you can engage in your national network, because we are currently present in 114 countries around the world. So go and check out what is the hubs in your world. Where are those projects in your region that you could link to, learn from, support, and let's really work together to bring this up to the next level.
Now, the permaculture people are supporting you here in New Zealand. Is that correct?
Well, it's permaculture people, and we see a natural progression often of permaculture people who are working for a long time in the gardens and then bringing permaculture design to community building And we see everywhere in the world permaculture people linking into Gen as they start working on whole community transformation. So where the 100 community gardens of Auckland start creating community cohesion that start transforming whole neighborhoods and Auckland as a whole into an eco-city. So I think it's a natural, deep, deep relationship between the permaculture network and the Gen network that has always been there from the start. And Rubina McCurdy here from New Zealand is one of the elders of the Global Ecovillage Network and of permaculture. And, you know, I'm really younger than her, you know, and back in the 90s, I was looking for those publications that linked permaculture to social permaculture and to community knowledge. And Rubina was actually one of those elders who inspired me so deeply in her writings. I found them on the internet. And it was really exciting when we re-met at the Gen Plus 20 conference in Findhorn and again at the Genoa, the Asian Oceania Ecovillage Network meeting. And it's also been Rubina inviting me to come and support her work around growing communities and ecovillages and linking ecovillage and Maori wisdom here in New Zealand.
Do you have monetary support from anyone, or is it all essentially donation based, or how does it all work? Because that's one of the big challenges around community is for land, to get the community going. I've got an interview with a person called Martin Large on the site, and I'm keen to make sure that people can get a foothold, get some foundations. How do, just quickly, because I know we want to talk about the higher virtues and values of what you offer, but land is a challenge and finance. Is there a way, or do people just first volunteer and then let it happen organically?
Oh, great question. Well, the heart of it is the fact that in Gen, I think we've come from roots where people have felt that economy is a bad thing and money is what is destroying the world. And it's been a real learning curve because there's been a kind of an approach to like, I have to be poor to be good, you know? And it's only through time that we're maturing into a place where we understand that we need to recreate economy in a way that nurtures life. And we can create economies, cyclical economies, economies of love, as the Sekhem Ecovillage in Egypt calls it, where we can create income in a way that nurtures and replenishes and regenerates nature, that regenerates the people that are working, and where the products heal society. So it's a completely different approach, very viable. And as we spread our work more and more to traditional villages in the global south, if we can't make a living while living our heart's intent, it doesn't work. We need to bring the two together. Our providing for our families, providing for our needs, not for our greed, providing while doing this work of regeneration. So there's a lot of focus currently on social entrepreneurship.
Oh, good.
In Gen and in Ecovillage.
Yes.
If we can't provide a way to make a living for the young people in Africa while they build their Ecovillage or transition their traditional village, we're not going anywhere. It's at the heart of what we do. But also in Gen as a whole, you know, we've had a first funder called Gaia Trust in Denmark who really supported Gen at the outset. And from there, we've been growing what we do also economically towards economic sustainability. It makes us strong. So we have three legs that we stand on. One is donations. So people can become a friend of Gen, offer a small monthly donation, or as individual donors. We have so many people who've harvested a lot of money from the current economic system who are richer than is possibly good for them or makes them happy, and who would love to pass on to the next generations.
Lovely.
So,
yes.
You know, check out the website. Yes. See whether this is what is calling you or see how you can pass on your wealth. But we also do projects. So project funding through the Green Climate Funds, the German Foreign Ministry Climate Funds, the Scottish Government, the European Union. So, you know, learning to build the capacity of the organization in a way that we can work closely together with some of these funds. We're currently having a project. You know, if you look at the World Banks, the development banks of the world, they have around $50 trillion ready to invest also in sustainable infrastructure development, of which only 20 to 30 trillion are actually expended every year. And because of the quality of applications, they don't have enough high quality applications. And we're currently starting to work together with a foundation called the Sustainable Infrastructure Foundation to develop a template specifically for eco-villages, for infrastructure projects between $500,000 and $1 million, which will help communities on the ground, especially in the Global South, but not only, to put in their applications for sustainable infrastructure. Because there's lots of funds swimming around there, especially the Green Climate Funds also, which often end up not in the right hands.
I agree with that.
And don't come through to the communities on the ground where the real change is happening.
True.
So we need to become able and available to channel those funds where they want to go, which is the communities that are implementing solutions now. And Jen is ready for that. We're doing that. The third leg that we're standing on is social entrepreneurship in Jen, and it's providing careers to our people. So we're building a whole pathway from growing solutions on the ground to becoming Gen ambassadors, Gen trainers, and Gen consultants, because we need more and more people to actually spread the skills as we start responding to requests by governments and other institutions. You know, we can help them implement the Sustainable Development Goals and the climate agreements. And we need people with these skills from the ground who also know about community empowerment,
yes,
participatory implementation.
That's it.
Of solutions to spread. So, you know, we're also calling on all the young people, if this is what you feel called to, don't despair. There is a pathway here, a learning journey that leads you through all those magical places globally, eco-villages, to learn, to enhance your skills, to become a trainer and consultant of what you love. And whether the core of what you bring is indigenous wisdom or, say, solar technologies or conflict facilitation, it doesn't matter. We need all of those skills. Come and join us, you know. Make this into your career.
This is fantastic, because we need the young to come on board now, because they are ripe for this. I'll tell you what, we're on a winner. So what I like, what you're saying, Kosha, is that you're offering a map with pathways. See, a lot of people want to change, but they haven't really had a map. And so what you're offering up is just, one, make that effort to connect. And then when enough people connect, they will form a nucleus. And they can all work together as a cell and then connect with other cells, and then clusters of cells, and it continues to grow like that across the nation everywhere. So, yeah, so this is wonderful. I really, really, really am so happy that you've come here to sow this seed, not to, I would say, fertilize the seed, to add an elixir seed to help us in New Zealand. Just take that extra step. Because we're Southern Hemispherians. I maintain we, in many ways, we are the right brain of the hemisphere, whereas the left brain of a hemisphere in some ways is Northern Hemisphere. And I know it's not necessarily like that, but we are, I feel, because of a lot of the indigenous peoples in Southern Africa and Australia and Aotearoa and also in South America, where these indigenous knowledge, where this is coming from. And it's awakening into the dream time, so to speak, and materializing our dreams for a new tomorrow. That's what I like about it. And you've come here at the right time. And I'm so glad, because I was going to ask you so many other questions about Ubuntu, which has come from South Africa, which is a marvelous word. It's a fantastic word. And so, yes, we're here for the great impetus.
Yeah, so Ubuntu, I am here because you are. And the direct connection to aroha is there. You just see it meeting.
Yes.
So we go out into the world with Ubuntu Aroha in our hearts. Can we bring that to every encounter that we have? As we meet the water, where does our water come from? Where does our food come from? You know, have we connected? How do we connect to the people we meet? Our neighbors in the street, our children, our elders. You know, we can bring, how do we do our work in the world? Do we earn our money in a way that is regenerating life? If not, how can we change, you know? And how deeply are we rooted in our cultures? So I'm just feel like we're all in this. It doesn't matter where you live, whether you live in Ecovillage or not. I know so many people would love to, but haven't yet found the path. We can start today, and we can become a part of this family today, wherever we are.
I love the word regenerative, the regeneration of everything. It's so, so important. And there's another word that I wanted to say. Namaste means I honor the light behind your eyes. I honor the God within you, or the Atman. And this is what we need to realize. It's not our body. It's not a male or female, or black, white, or brown. It's, in many ways, the light behind our eyes that's coming together in this form of a new global family that you are here for.
Yeah, and we need to, today, transform our human presence on this planet completely. And I think recognizing the light within each other is at the core of that. Thank you so much, Tim. I just want to thank you. It's been a joy having this conversation with you. Kia ora.
Yeah, fantastic. I've been speaking with Kosha Joubert of the Global Ecovillage Network, and their website is ecovillage.org. Ecovillage.org. It's all about connection, conscious choices, social resiliency, ecological restoration, economic sustainability, and cultural regeneration. The Findhorn website is findhorn.org. Findhorn.org. findhorn.org, which I visited and did a course way back in 1977. Another very interesting website is auroville.org, auroville.org, auroville.org. And I visited and worked in Auroville in 1978. It's a unique experience, like Findhorn. Check out Mondragon Corporation, Mondragon. It's in the Basque region in Spain and is a corporation and federation of worker cooperatives with 73,000 employees and assets of over 24 billion euros. I had a quick visit in 1992. Decide to network. Use every letter you write, every conversation you have, every meeting you attend, every email you send, and remember, even Facebook, to tweet and to express your fundamental beliefs and dreams. Affirm to others the vision of the world you want. Network through thought. Network through action. Network through love. Network through the spirit. You are the center of a network. You are the center of the world. You are a free, immensely powerful source of life and goodness. Affirm it, spread it, radiate it. Think day and night about it, and you will see a miracle happen. The greatness of your own life in a world of big powers, media and monopolies. But of 7.7 billion individuals, networking is the new freedom, the new democracy, a new transparency, and a new form of wholeness and happiness. This originated by Dr. Robert Mueller, Chancellor of the World Peace University in Costa Rica, Central America. I invite you to be able to come to greenplanetfm.com, where we have over 400 interviews in our database, which you can readily download and listen to be able to inspire yourself to become the change you want to see in the world. And become involved in caring for your children and grandchildren's future. We are also on Facebook, on Green Planet FM, and ourplanet.org. Please come and love us.